Last week, I shared a bit about how I had a very natural, very rational, very sane fear of heights. Now, I think most people do have some kind of fear of heights. It's based on this idea that, like, when I stand at the edge of a really significant drop, I should feel some kind of fear, like inside of my body. All of this is based on experience and knowledge, right? So maybe when I was a kid, I fell off of something that was kind of high. For me then, not high now. Fall off like a step. Fall off like, some playground equipment. That's a couple feet. It's not gonna seriously injure you, but it's enough to say like, huh, the higher I go, the greater my likelihood of getting actually seriously hurt is. And so when you stand at the edge of like a cliff and you look over, it's natural then to feel some kind of fear because your past experiences and your knowledge of reality suggest that if I fall, bad things will happen. That's often where our fears come from. Now, if you just have a completely irrational fear, I don't know that there's a lot I can do for you. You're a psychologist, maybe, but you know, me right now, Steve, where I am, I don't know, that's not really my specialty. The problem for a lot of us is that we don't actually know what we think we know. See, we take our fears, whatever your fears may be, and I'm not just talking about, you know, the kind of fears like sharks or clowns, which is a weird one, but that's a lot of y'all, or heights or whatever. I'm talking about the kind of big existential fears too. Fears of being alone, fears of failure, fears of loss, fears of grief. Those big fears. And the thing is, we think we know what's going to happen. Maybe it's based on past experience, maybe experiences that we've had in our own story, in our own lives. We think we know what's going to happen. The truth is, we don't actually know. Now, I'll give you a great example of this. When I was a kid, on Halloween, I was bit by a dog. It was a horrible experience. I'll explain it to you like this. Our next door neighbors had two dogs. One was a big black dog that was fairly friendly, all things considered. The other one was a white little Shih Tzu. And I did not like that dog, and that dog did not like me. I'd be playing basketball in the backyard, and my ball would roll down the hill into my neighbor's yard, and they had a fence where the dogs would stay in. The ball would roll against the fence, and every time I would be terrified to go down and get the ball because I knew that as soon as I got close, the little Shih Tzu would come just running out and just yipping away at me, right? And so this particular Halloween, went to the door, Indiana Jones costume and all, complete with hat, went to the door, rang the doorbell, got my candy, and as I turned to leave, that little Shih Tzu came running to the door, right, just barking up a storm. And in natural fear and trembling, I turned and I ran. I ran back to where my dad was. I guess my neighbors couldn't stop the dog or whatever the case may have been. The dog got out, chased me. Turns out it was faster than I was. And as I was running, it jumped and grabbed the meatiest part of me that it could, which turned out to be my hamstring. It's a little dog, right? If you've ever seen a Shih Tzu, they're not like, they're much fiercer than they look. You know, trust me on this one. So it bit my hamstring, didn't really cause any injuries, no problems. I don't even know if it left a mark or a bruise at all, but it was enough to traumatize me for a while. And so I developed this fear of dogs, which made sense, right? Based on my past experiences, that I would associate a dog, especially a dog barking, with being bitten by a dog. Well, that makes a lot of sense. The truth is that it's not necessarily a fair thing to take into my daily experience, to be afraid every time that I encounter a dog barking. Because here's the point, right? I would assume, based on my past experiences, that dog barking equals bite. There's a part in our brains, this kind of natural reflexive part of our brains, the lowest kind of animalistic instinct level in our brain that says, that makes these connections, these fight, flight, freeze mechanisms in our brain that say, okay, X incident results in Y outcome. And so if this happens, I'm going to have a certain response that is then going to keep me from Y outcome. Of course, the real problem is that I don't know that that's true, right? I don't actually know that every time I see a dog that it's going to bite me. As a matter of fact, there are a great many dogs that are very calm and benign. There are a great many dogs that bark for many different reasons. My oldest daughter loves Caesar Milan Dog Whisperer, and so I kind of know. I'm sort of an expert on dogs now, and they bark for a lot of different reasons. That's not true. I'm not a dog expert. Don't at me with your dog advice. I have no clue. But I do know that dogs bark for a lot of different reasons. So every time a dog barks, it's not because it's angry. It's not because it's going to bite you. There's a lot of very nice, fine, benign dogs in the world. There's some dogs that are even just very, very friendly. There are also some dogs that are just mean and vicious dogs and should be avoided at all costs, especially Shih Tzus. I don't want to hear anything else about it. They are vicious dogs. The point is this. I don't know that every time I see a dog, it's going to bite me. And yet there was a part of my brain that just instinctively responded with fear any time that I encountered a dog. It's this idea of being afraid of the unknown, ultimately, right? Because while I think that I know, the truth is I don't know. I don't know how it's going to respond. It's ultimately that unknown that causes the fear. So I just want you to think about that as we start our discussion today, because we're in the fourth week of Advent. What we're actually talking about this week is this great Advent theme of love. And I want to start with fear, because fear is the great inhibitor to love. Now, to love in the classic biblical sense of the word, the New Testament sense of the word love, means to will the good of another without regard to self. And yet the greatest inhibitor of that very often in our lives is fear. Now, it's a fear of a variety of things, fear of missing out, fear of being late, fear of failure, fear of loss, fear of, ultimately, I think, the unknown and the uncertain. It's fear. So what we're going to be looking at today is kind of how we make sense of that in light of the Advent story and the Christmas story, and look at a wonderful example from the Christmas story, the life of Mary and this encounter she has with the angel and then her response to it in a moment when she is herself experiencing a great deal of fear. And so maybe as we just jump in, I'd like you to consider what it was like for you before doing any of those kind of scary things that you've experienced. Because if there's one thing that I do know about you, it's that you have been afraid before. Most of us have, as a matter of fact. Actually, all of us have. Fear is a very natural response to unknown. And whatever that may have been, whether it was starting a new job for the first time, going to a new place, meeting new people, going on a date, getting married, going to a new church. I mean, I think maybe in my own life, looking back, going on deployment, going to ranger school, having kids, where, there's just so much buildup and potentially things that could go wrong, but you just simply don't know. And so in the absence of that knowledge, what I tried to do is I tried to fill myself with information. And so I would go and I'd read all the books. I mean, before having kids, I was reading all different kinds of parenting stuff, trying to figure out how I can prepare. Before going to ranger school, I'd ask all sorts of different people what it was like. Before deploying, I read all sorts of stuff on Afghanistan and other people's experiences and tried to gain as much information as possible. But there's a significant problem here, and it's this, that we have this lie in our world that information alone is enough to solve all of our problems. The problem is that information alone doesn't solve our problems. What we actually need is knowledge. See, what I wanted was not information, I wanted knowledge. But knowledge requires experience. And that's a hard thing, right? Knowledge is acquired information that turns out to be true that then is lived out in our own experience. That's knowledge. So when we are in a place where we are afraid, or in a situation we're afraid, when I think ultimately we can root those fears in a sense of the unknown, what we need then is some kind of knowledge to assuage the fears, some kind of knowledge to drive out the fears, which is where this wonderful theme of love comes in. As I said, I think fear is a natural and normal response to the unknown, the uncertain, the unexpected, but it was not always so. In the beginning, you look at Genesis 1 and 2, it's this wonderful story of God creating a good world. And in the middle of that world is kind of the capstone of his creation. He creates human beings in his own image. Genesis 1, 26, 28, you read about this. In the beginning, God created human beings in the image of God. He created them, male and female, he created them. And he gave them dignity and dominion and stewardship over the creation. And in that place, there was a lot of new. The world was new. Human beings were new. Everything was new. And in that sense, there was a lot of stuff that was unknown. A lot of things that were becoming known for the first time, and yet there was no fear. Is that not interesting? Fear doesn't enter into the story until much later on in Genesis 3, which we'll talk about in a moment. And so I guess I would just ask, in that place in Genesis 1 and 2, when faced with the unknown and there was no fear, what then was the attitude? What then was the posture? What then was the response? And how was that possible. Because see, what happens then in Genesis 3 is fascinating, right? Is that this is the entrance of evil into the story, the entrance of the serpent. In the beginning, God tells Adam, he says, you may eat from the fruit of any tree in the garden, but do not eat from the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. For if you do, you will surely perish. The serpent then comes to Eve in Genesis 3 and says, did God really say that you couldn't eat fruit from any of the trees? Which is itself a lie, but part of the clever ruse of the serpent. Eve says, that's not true. Hold on, let me think back to what God said. At the root of this temptation to eat is to reach out and take from the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But it's ultimately this kind of questioning and trusting of God. Is God really good? Will he really secure good outcomes for you? Surely he's holding out on you. Now, quick pause on that. Remember back to our definition of love, to will the good of the other without regard to self. Now, we have as our basic concept of reality from a Christian worldview, the basic map of reality is that at the center of reality is the triune God of love, Father, Son, and Spirit. That relationship, that Godhead, God is love. The Father willing the good of the Son and the Spirit willing the good of the Son willing the good of the Father and the Spirit. This community of love. And that is from that place that creation flows, and that the redemption of humanity is that we are brought back into that circle of love. And so we see then in Genesis 1 and 2 is that it's from this overflow of love that God creates the world. And Adam and Eve living, I mean, humanity ensconced in this community of love, which is intricately and intimately tied to the idea of the good. And so you see then what the serpent attacks is this idea that God actually loves. That God actually loves. Is God really got your best interests in mind? Is God holding out a good, withholding a good from you? In other words, does God really love you? Maybe just ask yourself that question. Does God really love me? Do I have a belief, a genuine belief that God really loves me, that he really wants and works for the good in my life, that he really is willing the good, that the creator of the cosmos is actively willing the good into my life every single moment of every single day? And in a world like ours, that can be very difficult to believe sometimes, where there is sin and brokenness and sickness and death and wars and rumors of wars, and it can be hard to believe sometimes that there is a God who is actively willing my good every moment of every day. But that is the wonder of the gospel story. And that is the message that Jesus came to proclaim. Going back to Genesis 3, when the serpent comes into the garden and questions the love and the goodness of God, and then tempts Eve to pick the fruit from the tree and then shares it with Adam, and they eat from the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What then happens, right? It is the first time that we experience fear. I mean, the immediate response is they realize they're naked and they are ashamed. And so what do? They hide. God walks into the garden in the cool of the day, at the time of the evening breeze, we're told, this wonderful picture of God on just an evening stroll. Picture like a casual June night, you know, just as the sun's starting to go down, nice breeze blowing, God strolling into the garden, and Adam and Eve are hiding. And God asks the question, he says, where are you? And Adam's response is very telling. He says, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. So see, ultimately what is introduced here in a very real sense, I mean, yes, sin and death and all of those things, but one of the consequences is fear. This questioning of the goodness of God, this questioning of the known, that I know that God will secure my good, this kind of sense that I don't know what's going to happen, which is why Adam hides. Right? He doesn't know how God's going to respond. He doesn't know if God's going to be angry. He doesn't know if God's going to just smite him right there. He does not know. Not that he couldn't have known, because he knew before. There was no question before. But it is the entrance of sin that then induces fear into our lives. Fear ultimately is the result of a separation from God. See, in acquiring the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, what we lose, while we gain a knowledge of the good and evil, right? What we lose is a knowledge of God's essential nature, we lose this knowledge, this experiential knowledge, that God is love and that he is constantly willing our good. See, it's almost like a shifting of perspective, right? The evil still existed, but it is the kind of vacuous opposite of the good, right? It only exists as a privation of the good. It's the classical definition of evil, that evil exists as a privation and of the good. And so what we see then in the story is that it is where we live in this place where we fixate and focus on this negative, and we lose sight of the overwhelming positive that is the love and the willing of the good of God. Now, if that's a little dense, or maybe that doesn't make a lot of sense, I'll put it in maybe a simpler way that I perhaps should have done in the first place, which is this. The biblical wisdom is that the antidote to fear is not trying hard not to be afraid. The antidote to fear is not trying to read more books. The antidote to fear is not having lots of conversations to figure out all that you can about a given situation. The antidote to fear is love. I love the way the Apostle John puts it. He says, there is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out, drives out all fear. The biblical antidote to fear is love. And what I find so remarkable, and what this has to do with Christmas and Advent, is this, that when we look at the Christmas story in Luke 1 and 2 and Matthew 1 and 2, one of the themes that we see very prominent is fear. Over and over and over again. We find fear when Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, is approached by the angel. We find fear when Mary is approached by an angel. We find fear when Joseph is approached by an angel. We find fear when the shepherds are approached by an angel. We find fear in Herod the king when he is approached with his message from the wise men. We find fear at so many steps in this journey in the Christmas story. And I want you to just consider, you look at Luke chapter 1, is where we're going to be looking at today, 26 to 38. In that text, you can go and read that if you like. I'm not going to read it for us, but what you find is that Mary shows us a possible pathway of transformation from fear to love. Just one example in this. And all of these people, they've responded in different ways. Herod perhaps responding the worst, letting those fears drive him to literal massacre. But Mary has a wonderful transformative pathway that I'd like for us to just think about and spend a little time contemplating together. I'll give you a quick recap of the story, and I'll read sections of it as we go through. So that'll be helpful for us. We'll all be on the same page. But if you want to go look, Luke chapter 1, you got a Bible or got it open on your computer or your phone, or you want to flip over, feel free to do so. This is what we hear, though, is that an angel shows up and tells her this. He says, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at these words. It's kind of a troubling thing, right? Greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Another way of saying that she was greatly troubled was that she was afraid. It's just a sense in there's a deep disturbance within her. She was afraid in that moment and wondered what in the world is going on. This kind of thing doesn't happen every day. So what does Mary then do in her state of greatly troubledness? This is what we hear beginning in verse 30. The angel says to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will have no end." The message of the angel is very interesting and worth spending a little bit of time considering. He says, "You are highly favored." Now, that word that's translated favor, it's also translated variously in the New Testament as grace. It's a wonderful little Greek word, charis. And oftentimes when we think about the idea of grace, we do kind of put it simply as this idea of favor, that, you know, it's undeserved, unmerited favor from God. But what does that really mean? See, when we define grace in that way, it really doesn't get us a better definition. What is the favor of God, right? Well, in a way, it's God's wanting our good, God's willing and working to our good, the blessing of God, willing our good. And if you'll then make that short jump back to what we talked about a minute ago, that is love. So what is favor? What is grace? It is God's loving activity in our lives. That's grace. So notice that what is on offer here is the grace, the favor, the unmerited, wonderfully all-encompassing love of God for Mary. Not because she's some kind of special person, person in and of herself just because she is. I love this line from Dallas Willard. I go back to it so often. We often think that it's a miracle that God loves us. When we look at our own lives, when we look at our own sin, our own brokenness, all the struggles that we have, we often think it's a miracle that God loves us. He says, it's not a miracle that God loves you. It'd be a miracle if he didn't love you, because that's just who he is, and that's just what he does. And I think when we can regain that vision of who God is, it changes so much. Because it changes it from God kind of stubbornly, grudgingly consenting to love us, to understand that's just who he is. He is love. And to genuinely then come to believe that that's true. So we see here is what's on offer is God's loving activity in Mary's life. And that it's then made personal, right? God knows her name. He doesn't respond, hey, you girl over there. It's Mary, Mary, Mary. It's a personal address. This is love, right? The personal presence and availability of God in our life, willing our good. Now, I certainly do want to say that Mary has a unique role in the history of the salvation story. And you can ask all the questions about why and how come and what's this mean. But at the end of it and ultimately, what I do want us to see is that Mary is not loved by God because she is simply the mother of Jesus. Mary is beloved by God because she is a human being. And God loves human beings. He made human beings. He decreed that they were very good at the very beginning of creation. And that's the message that he's communicating through this story, through all the stories to us, that you are deeply loved and valued by God. So first, this is what we hear, right? That in this place of fear and greatly troubledness, that Mary simply listens to the message, that she is loved by God, that she is valued and accepted, and that it's personal, right? She accepts the personal, loving activity of God in her life. And she then responds, interestingly, right? She voices her doubts and her fears and says this, how will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin? How will it be that God is actively going to work in my life since I have not done anything to make it so, right? In some ways, while this is a specific question to this story and certainly has, a lot of ramifications, I think you can take a step back and maybe apply it in a broader sense to your own life, right? How can it be that God will do something in my life when I've done nothing to make it so? How can this be? How will this be so? How will God secure good outcomes for me in my life? How will he work in my life when I have done nothing to contribute, nothing to add to it, nothing to make this possible? Voice those questions, right? That I think it's a good thing for us to remember that when confronted with fear or doubts or questions or worries, you need to give voice to them. It's one of the things I love about the Psalms. You read through the Psalms and in the Hebrew Bible, they're not these just kind of happy, clappy, everything's going to be okay prayers. I mean, they are gut-level prayers that are often, I would say, a little bit rude to God. God, where are you? How come you're asleep on the job? How come you're not helping me? What's wrong with you? Are you not paying attention over here? God, have vengeance on my enemies. Kill my enemy. These are visceral, deep prayers. So think about that. It's okay to voice your fears, your doubts, your questions, and your concerns. As a matter of fact, I would say it's dangerous if you don't. Because then what you end up doing is you end up just stuffing it down and pretending like it's not there, but really it is. And you never bring that into the light and love of God. And so Mary listens to the message. She voices her own doubts and fears. And then she responds with a certain sense of trust in this promise. We hear this. This is a response from the angel. How will this be so? I mean, isn't this wonderful that God responds to those questions of fear and doubt? He says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God shall ever fail. It's this then a promise that comes in response that God is going to do this thing. There is a wonderful explanation of how God is going to do it, but not the specifics, right? God is going to move in power in your life. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. You will be consumed by the love of God, and he will make this to be so. But I love that line in verse 37, right? For no word from God will ever fail. No word from God will fail. That what God speaks or wills will come to pass in his own way, in his own time. Now that can be very difficult for us in a variety of ways, where we can often get confused about what is a word from the Lord or the will of God. and especially when it gets into the minutia of our daily experience and daily circumstances. Because the truth is, when you know you read the biblical story, there's a lot of things that the Bible is very clear on about what God's will is, but there's a lot of other things that perhaps he's not very clear on in your own daily life. Should I take this job or that job? Should I date this person or not? Should I marry this person or not? Should I give or not? Should I serve here or not? Should I invest in this relationship or should I not? There's so many questions over the course of our daily life that get so muddy and uncertain and unclear. And very often when we ask those questions to God, sometimes we don't get the response that we want. Sometimes we do get a response, or we think is a response, and it maybe doesn't seem to come to pass in the way and time that we expect. But this wonderful word in verse 37 is that no word from God will fail, that what God speaks or wills will come to pass in his way and his time. And ultimately what God wills, ultimately what his word, his declaration over us is for our good. Now the specific details may change, and those may be dependent very much on our circumstances in our own life, but the will of God is for good in our lives. This is what it means for God to love us, to will our good without any regard to self, to will our good. And so just think about that, right? With whatever the maybe uncertain place in your life is that you're facing, if there's maybe an area of fear in your life that you're experiencing, think about that. And I was reminded of this word from Isaiah 55, verses 10 through 12. This is what Isaiah writes. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, this is from the Lord. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. No word from God will ever fail. That's the message that Isaiah is conveying here in Isaiah 55. But I do want us to think about this for just a moment, right? When God uses this illustration of the rain and the snow coming down and watering the fields that then produces crop. I mean, I want you to think about that, right? That is a process that takes time, isn't it? The rain takes time to make the ground bud and flourish. I mean, how much time elapses between rain from the sky producing grain of wheat that's then plucked and harvested and used to make bread? That's a process. That's a system that sometimes takes quite a lot of time. Our challenge is that very often we think that the word from the Lord should happen immediately, like right now, when I want it to. When very often the will of God being projected in the world, the kingdom of God, Jesus said, it's like a mustard seed. It's the smallest of things and starts in the smallest of ways, but then over time it will grow naturally and gradually and then produce fruit. But it will take time. And I think part of the reason for that is, you know, the Apostle Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient. Love is patient. Love is not in a hurry. Love doesn't demand things to happen in its own way and time. Love learns to wait. Love learns to wait, which is the essential theme of Advent in all of its totality, is learning to wait. And so what it then looks like for us is just to have this posture of learning to wait upon the Lord, learning to wait in his timing. This is then where we find Mary, right? To believe and to trust this promise that no word from God will fail, that he will ultimately work things out for good, that if the Lord has willed it, it will come to pass. The specifics, the details, the hows, the whats, the wheres, the whens, those may be a little unclear and may be murky and may seem like they will necessarily be in flux and may seem like they won't come to pass. But that is the trust element that we have, is to trust that if God said it, that it will come to pass. If God decrees it, it will come to pass. And very often, I just want to broaden this out for us. This is the good that God is willing for your life. It may take different specific forms, but very just generally and broadly, it's this idea that God is willing good into your life. And if your circumstance of your life doesn't look good now, well, then it's not over yet. It's not over yet. God is willing good into your life. And ultimately, this passes through these dark moments and dark places in every story, in all of our stories, that God is then working out good on the other side. Mary listens to the message, she voices her doubt, she trusts the promise, and then ultimately it's this wonderful surrender to God's will. I love verse 38. Her response is that, "I am the Lord's servant, may your word to me be fulfilled." In other translations, "I am the servant of the Lord, may it be with me according to thy word." That's a great line for us to think about surrender and surrendering our will to God. Dallas Willard talked about this idea that the will doesn't actually have any power. This idea of willpower, it's a bit of a misnomer. What the will is really good at is surrendering. It was made to surrender. You surrender to all kinds of things. Surrender to the mind, surrender to the desires. Ultimately, the will was made to surrender to God. And in Mary, we see this wonderful illustration. "I am the Lord's servant. May it be with me according to your word." Maybe that's a good place for you to sit, especially if you're facing kind of a fearful, uncertain circumstance in your own life, to just kind of bring that into your mind, maybe just to work on that, to recite that kind of regularly throughout your day. Anytime you start to feel that rise up, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be with me according to your word." Mary surrenders to God's will. This is the movement of love, I think, from trying to figure out how to make good things work in my own life to then willing the good of another and trusting that somehow, some way, that will make things work in my own life better than I ever could. See, because what Mary is ultimately showing us is what it means to love God. So remember that we talked about love is to will the good of another without regard to self. And we talk a lot of times about God's love for us. I think about how God's love drives out fear, and we can have an awareness and a realization that love is at the center of the cosmos, and that God is willing and working for our good, and that you really can trust him. And to genuinely believe in that is to believe and receive the love of God. But there is that flip side to it. What does it mean then for me to love God? I mean, you've heard perhaps the great commandment to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, strength, and soul, to love your neighbors yourself. We spend a lot of time talking sometimes about the loving thy neighbor part. But what then does it mean to love the Lord? Sometimes we reduce it to just good feelings about God or certain acts of duty or compliance. We go to worship, we watch some videos, we sing songs, we pray. What does it actually mean to love God? Well, it means to will the good of God without regard to yourself, which is an interesting concept to think about. And what we see Mary doing here is saying, you know, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be with me according to thy will. Thy will be done, thy kingdom come, on earth as it is in heaven." This is how Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And ultimately, at the end of the gospel stories, when Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane and praying, and he says, "Father, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but your will be done." Surrender is an act of love for God. It is to will what is good for God. It is to care more about what good God wants to accomplish in the world. It is to care about the perceived good that I think needs to happen in my world. That's what it means to love God. And so in Mary, then, we see this wonderful illustration of what that looks like. "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me according to your word." How often in this place of fear in my own life am I asking the question, what is good for God in this? What is good for God in this? You know, a few weeks ago, I took vacation, and as I was going, my oldest daughter, she was asking me, she says, "You know, Dad, what are you doing? Where are you going?" I told her I was going to see a concert. Andrew Peterson, if you know him, wonderful singer-songwriter, did a great concert, Behold the Lamb of God. It's this Christmas narrative, really, that's in song from really the Exodus up through to the birth of Jesus. I did a horrible job explaining that, but you can go look it up. Behold the Lamb of God, Andrew Peterson. But he also wrote some children's books that we really love. My daughter and I we love to read those. We've had a great time reading those together. And so I told her that I was going to see him in concert for this Behold the Lamb of God tour. And her response was just excitement for me. I was actually kind of surprised. She's 7 years old, going on like 37, feels like. But she said, "Dad, I'm so happy for you. I hope you have such a good time and it's relaxing and restful," which was not what I was expecting, right? A lot of times seven-year-olds say, "Well, how come I'm not going?" Right? It's very self-focused. But what I realized, she had this moment where she was more concerned about what was good for me than she cared about what happened to her. And I cannot tell you how much that meant to me as a dad, to just hear my wonderful, sweet little daughter say, "Dad, I really hope you have the best time." That meant a lot to me. And so I think for us is perhaps to take this idea of just rather than every circumstance and every situation in our lives, just focusing on how it affects us, ask, Lord, what's good for you in this? Maybe especially if we're facing uncertainty or different questions, Lord, what do you want to happen here? Lord, what would be good for you in this? Maybe ask that question, just like Mary. I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me according to your word. So as we just wrap things up today, just say, you know, is there an area of your life where you're afraid today? Is there an area of life where you're experiencing some fear, anxiety, or worry? Just sit with that for a minute. Is it based on past experiences or some maybe known things that you think you are certain of that are going to come to pass? Just maybe sit with that. What is this area of fear? And then maybe ask that second question. If I surrender this place to receive the love of God, do I really believe the love of God? That he is genuinely good and will bring good things into my life. Do I really believe that? Do I really live like that's true? Am I willing to surrender this area of my life to him? Am I willing to say, I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me according to your will. Am I willing to say that? Am I willing to say, Lord, what is good for you in this situation? What's that look like for you? You know, when I was bitten by that dog, traumatic experience that it was, I turned around and I ran back to my dad. And what I did, I don't remember much of that whole experience. I really don't even remember the dog biting me, but I remember turning around and running and throwing myself into the arms of my dad. And I think very often this is the picture that I think is so helpful for us when it comes to fear, is that you can turn and run and just sit and be paralyzed in your fear, or you can turn and run into the arms of your Father, who is waiting and ready and willing to receive you. That's the central message of the gospel. God saying, I love you, and I'm here for you. That is the message of Christmas. Emmanuel, God with us. God saying, I love you, and I'm here for you. And when you're ready to turn around and run to me, my arms are open wide, and I will receive you. So if you would, I'd just like to pray for you today, however you may find yourself, that you would be able to receive and live in the love of God, and that you would hand over whatever fears you may be experiencing today to him. Father, I thank you for that grace. Thank you that you do offer yourself to us. I pray that whatever fears we may have, that you would help us to surrender those to you, to ask what is good for you in these situations and circumstances, to be able to say with Mary, I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me according to thy word. And to turn and run from all of the things that we feel like are assaulting and assailing us, to turn and run to the arms of our Father and to throw ourselves into them. We bless you and we thank you for that gift. And I pray all this upon everyone watching this, that they would know and experience the love of God today and this week. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, if there's anything that we can do, reach out. Do let us know. Love to hear from you. Subscribe to this YouTube channel if you haven't already. Just find all the information you need in the comments below. That's what all the kids say, so I'm pretty sure that's a thing. We'll have something under there in the comment content info box. I'm going to stop because I don't know what I'm talking about. But you can find all that information below. In the meantime, y'all have a great week. Make a great day. We will have a message coming out on Christmas Eve that I'd love to share with you. But until then, take care. God bless. We'll see you then.